So basically, there's effectively two broad categories of the way languages die. One would be sudden death, and one would be gradual death. Sudden death is quite rare, and gradual death is what is the norm. And so a sudden death basically comes in two forms. And in recorded history, we know of a few instances where a catastrophic event basically eliminated the speaker population of a language, and with it, that language more or less ceased to exist. Now, in all of those cases, there's likely to be survivors and likely to be remnants of that community that extended, you know, for the lifetime of at least the speakers of those people that managed to survive. But the vast majority of speakers died in a catastrophic event. And so the first type that I mentioned would be natural disasters. And there are a couple of different examples of this. One would be the volcanic explosion that happened in Tambora in modern Indonesia, which basically wiped out the Tamboran language in one moment. And there, of course, were a few speakers that survived. But for the most part, that entire speech community ceased to exist on one day in 1815. So too, more recently, in July of 1998, there was a catastrophic earthquake and landslide and then a tsunami that happened in northern New Guinea that basically wiped out a couple of different languages, possibly as many as four, completely overnight. Sisano and Arab Sisano were two of these languages that were wiped out because the entire community was inundated by a tsunami and only people that weren't present in the village that day survived. Basically, there were no survivors, or there were very, very few survivors, and the survivors dispersed to other communities, and the language basically ceased to have a community to use it at that point. So those are kind of natural disasters that lead to sudden death with language. There are also a couple of recorded instances of human orchestrated sudden death, so massacres of communities. So probably the most famous historically is the Shisha, or the Tangut Empire language, that the Mongols completely wiped out in 1227 as a revenge for a mistreatment of a young Chinggis Khan who was captured by them. And he vowed one day to eliminate the Shisha from history, and he basically almost did. They were forgotten in history until the 20th century, when various archaeological and linguistic records were unearthed that people managed to remember the Shisha. More recently, in modern history, there was a horrific massacre that occurred in El Salvador in, I believe, 1932, where the Kakapera and the Lenca people were effectively massacred en masse, and that effectively ended those as functional languages as well. So those are sort of a couple of examples of what we might call sudden glotticide or sudden language death. But more frequently, what we're looking at when we're looking at language death in a broader perspective is a gradual decline, and these are due to social factors. Okay, so, and now there's different paradigms for that lead to that. And gradual is a relative term. So there are some that you might call sudden because it's relatively fast, maybe a couple of generations, and then other ones, it's more of a 4, 5, 6 generational phenomenon where a language community starts adopting another language, and eventually the people who were the original language users die off. And then, you know, you have a generation where you have semi-speakers and rememberers, and then eventually you don't have anything other than maybe a few words that people, you know, have borrowed into the dominant language of the area that they shifted to. So this is your standard scenario that we find across the world today, but it's caused by different factors, which I'll talk about in a second. So even that's not a one-size-fits-all scenario. Now, there are some more sudden, very short, let's say narrow windows of where you went from initial triggering events. Typically, this would be associated with conquest or colonization of some sort, where you go from contact to extinction in a relatively short time. So the languages of Tasmania would fall into a category like this. They were first contacted, I believe, in 1803. And I think the last speaker of a Tasmanian language died in 1876. So it's roughly 75 years that they went from contact to extinction. There's a few other examples. The Cayuse language here in Oregon is another one that the Lewis and Clark expedition was effectively the first, in the early 19th century, was effectively the first contact they had with the external vector that was going to trigger this catastrophic social shift. And effectively, the language was gone by the end of the 19th century, although I believe the last speakers didn't die until like the early 20th century, maybe the 1930s or something. So this would be a relatively short period of from initial contact to non-existence. But more typically, what we're finding is a process of that shift unfolding over multiple generations. And the causes of this are varied. You know, having just discussed some colonialist situations, that is, if you look at a map of the world's languages today and you look at the areas which are most severely endangered, all of them share one thing in common. They share the fact that there was a very aggressive colonialist paradigm that started sometime a couple of hundred, you know, a few hundred years ago, up to a couple hundred years ago, and progressed rather dramatically across the communities that were in place at that initial contact period. So this would be what we find throughout North America. So Canada and the United States, of course, are canonically like this. And Siberia, certainly within Russia, is a canonical colonialist situation, and the language endangerment there is quite severe. Most of the languages are nearly extinct there. Brazil, moving in an east to west fashion. So eastern Brazil is largely depopulated of indigenous languages, but that process is still ongoing in the western Amazonian rainforest area. So Mexico and Argentina, you have a more of a center periphery. So in the center, the languages were eliminated relatively early, but that process is still ongoing in the periphery. So that's wave, you know, sort of in a wave out from the central colonial area. Australia is another classic and canonical settlement colony situation. So these are settlement colonies where you're finding conquerors coming and replacing the population and trying to create new versions of their old homelands. Okay, so settlement colonies are where you have most severe language endangerment. I would also personally throw Sudan into this category. Maybe other people would disagree with that, but the Arab colonization of northern Sudan, which went from basically north east to across the west into the south, still ongoing in the horrific things going on in Sudan even today in the Nuba Mountains. So this is canonical and classic colonialist expansion. It just wasn't Europeans on boats that got in and moved somewhere else. It was Arabs over land, but it's still the same process. When you're looking at the social impact and the linguistic impact of a community. So that's your sort of, in the mindset of most people, your standard paradigm or language shift. But that's not the only one. And so there are other more varied types of scenarios that are happening, that have happened or still happening. So one thing that we've seen in the post-World War II period, just to take a random date, it's mid-20th century, is the emergence of nation states that rally around a national language identity. And in the majority of these instances, it is the language of the ethnic majority, the dominant but also majority population. Now, this would be true of basically all of Europe, almost in the entirety of European countries would fall into that category. But also, it's very common in Southeast Asia and in Eastern Asia. So China, certainly Thailand, Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, Myanmar, or Burma, depending on which way you want to call it, those all basically deal with the same situation. In the Eastern Asian scenario, you have a hierarchy, a language hierarchy that's institutionalized, where you have the national dominant majority ethnic language as the top language. And then you have various officially recognized minority groups. And then you have the unofficial minority groups, so the unrecognized minority groups. And so you have a very obvious climb in hierarchy that you're more likely, the lower you are on that hierarchy, the more likely you are to have your language at risk. And you know, the top level, their languages of education, of official business, of science, they're not at risk at all. That is a language like Thai in Thailand or Chinese in China. But the official minority languages have some kind of state support, so they get some you know, support that helps them be maintained. But the unofficial minority languages get no such support, and those are so this, all of that basically derives from 19th century sociological theories that were adopted by Joseph Stalin and institutionalized in the Soviet Union, and then more or less adopted by those countries in Southeast Asia. So that's That's a process of sort of official ethnicities that permeates, you know, a lot of the sort of Soviet and quasi-communist regimes that have existed, and then adopted to varying degrees in other locations. I would call that scenario a neo-nationalist, internal neo-colonialist paradigm. That's what I would refer to that personally as, that other people might call that something else, but it's very much rooted in a national identity and a hierarchy of languages based on that creation of a national identity where the first among equals is the ethnic majority language. Now, there are other countries that have followed that same kind of pattern, but don't have an ethnic majority per se. Actually, in that first paradigm, I wanted to add, it's not just a European or Asian thing. So we find southern Indian states where you have a majority language ethnic group. So this would be like Tamil Nadu or Andhra Pradesh, where Telugu dominates, or these would fall in that same category, and also Assam in the north. But in Africa, we find Botswana and Senegal also following that same kind of pattern, where a majority population has taken over the politics in a post-colonial setting, and has basically replaced the European colonizers as the dominant group. That's effectively what's happened in those areas. And true to form, language endangerment, for example, in Botswana is progressing rather rapidly. Now, another sort of scenario which we find in other areas, also in, say, Africa and Asia, is, again, a neo-nationalist identity where a single group is being promoted, but they aren't necessarily the dominant numerically, but they are the more dominant socially group. So this would be like, for example, the rise of Amharic in Ethiopia. The Oromo are actually numerically larger in Ethiopia, but the Amhara have all the power. So Amharic is the language that's being the replacing and target language for the shift for most of the languages, as opposed to Oromo, which is, as I said, actually statistically speaking, slightly higher in the numerical reckoning of the population than the Amhara are. This would also be what we get in northern India in the Hindi sphere, where Hindi is rapidly expanding at the expense of other languages. There, you know, it's tied to both ethnic, neo-nationalist, and religious ideologies. Another interesting scenario you find in the Philippines and Indonesia, where they basically, very explicitly in Indonesia and more recently in the Philippines, created a national language, which is supposed to be de-ethnicized, but more or less took over what was the economically most powerful language. And these languages are being promoted and expanding at the expense of the minority languages. So in all these cases, what you're dealing with is an institutionalization of a hierarchy of identities. And the people who are at the lower end of the identity hierarchy basically have no choice but to assimilate and shift. And that's what the major trigger of language endangerment is, even in the colonialist scenarios, is a power imbalance between communities. And a perceived way to rectify those power imbalances is to shed one of the vectors of discrimination, that being your language, because these languages are devalued socially and economically. And the main, that's, you can't change, for example, your skin color, okay? So like racialized identities are difficult to change, but you can change the language you choose to speak in public. And therefore, and once these ideologies get internalized, then people want to no longer speak them in public. And you often hear, you know, we work with all kinds of indigenous communities all over the world. And they often say, you know, it's like, well, what's the point of teaching them blank language? They need to know this other language to get ahead socially, economically, through school, through economic opportunities, et cetera, et cetera. So the last sort of scenario that we see, if we look globally, is where post-colonial contact languages have taken over as lingua francas. So this would be like pidginized or creolized forms of English, for example, Tokpisin in Papua New Guinea or Bislama in Vanuatu, which these languages. So we in here, what you basically are getting are rapidly urbanizing populations in a highly multilingual setting and with traditionally fairly little access to the original standard colonial language. But what arose was this creolized form of based on the colonial languages. So this is something that we see over and over in various places. But I think those are Papua New Guinea is really a canonical instantiation of that, where we're finding the rapid spread of Tokpisin at the expense of the many, many hundreds, literally, of languages that are traditionally spoken in Papua New Guinea. Now, in terms of death scenarios, there's basically two types that we find. One is a sort of top-down, another one is a bottom-up death. The top down is the most common one. So basically languages get restricted in their domains of use to the point where it's basically grandmothers in the kitchen talking together and nothing else. And so that's the scenario we find for most language endangerment scenarios, is it gets narrowed so much so that it becomes only a family language and then only a small portion of the family and then only in certain contexts. There may be some use of this in ritual, traditional activities, festivals and such, but it's often symbolic and not real, as opposed to, you know, active use of the language. And the other scenario, which is sort of the reverse of that, is that it eroded from the bottom up. So only the very highest sort of strata are used the language, or only the most high styles of the language are preserved. And this would be like, for example, what happened with Hebrew, where it was only preserved as a liturgical language in the religious ceremonies. Also Ge'ez in Ethiopia and Coptic in the Egyptian scenario. These are situations where languages have died from the bottom up. So they've only been preserved basically as religious liturgical texts and used in religious ceremonies and in no other contexts. And that scenario also exists in other languages that aren't written, but those are probably the three best known examples because they have this written tradition where they got institutionalized in various religious contexts and things. So that anyway is more or less my view of the typology of language death. Other people might have different views on this, but that's where I see as the most defensible and reasonable approaches to this.